This story is the story of Amalfi and the Flying Palace. Once, there was an old couple who had not been blessed with any children. They were very sad about this and wished and wished and wished that they would be granted with a son, even one son or one daughter, and their hearts would have been filled with joy. Well, while they did not have any children, they did have an apple tree, a tall one that grew in their yard. And each day, the woman would walk outside, walk around the tree three times, and then say, "Oh, please, gods in the heavens, if I could only be granted with a child." She did this every day for weeks. Months even, some say years, when all of a sudden, one day, three apples fell from the tree and landed at her feet. The minute she picked up the apples, what happened? They split in half, and inside each of the apples was a small baby. A baby! Each one fit in her palm of her hand. She called to her husband, who ran out. They picked up the three boys and brought them inside. And you would think they would stay tiny, but they did not. They grew to be strong boys, three strong sons. They were alike in many ways, and so they named them each Amalfi. The first Amalfi, the second Amalfi, and the third Amalfi. And when they grew to be young men, the father took all three and said, "It is time now for you to go out into the world and seek your fortune. First Amalfi, you will go first." And his mother packed him in a sack, a loaf of barley bread to take with him on his journey. Off went the first Amalfi, leaving his two brothers and his parents at home. He had not traveled far when he came upon a white-haired old man sitting by the side of the road. "Hello," said the first Amalfi. "Hello," said the old man. Do you think you have some food that you could spare with me? For I am very hungry." "Well, of course," said the first Amalfi, and he sat beside the old man, took out the barley loaf, and the two shared the bread and ate all of it. When they were finished, the white old man stood. He seemed stronger than before, and he looked at the first Amalfi and said, "If you listen to me, I will tell you how you can find your fortune." "All right," said the first Amalfi, "I will listen. Sleep here in this field, and when the first star rises at the night, notice which way its rays point, for that will tell you which way to go. Follow the rays of the star. Don't ever doubt. Follow the rays of the star, and you will come to a stream. It will be rushing. It will look like it is impossible to cross, but it is an enchanted stream. So step out into it bravely, and you will be able to cross it. When you get almost to the other side, there will be lilies floating in the water. They will be the most beautiful lilies you've ever seen. Don't pick them. Get to the other side and continue on your journey. Then you will reach the meadow. In the meadow, all of the blades of grass are silver, and the roses that grow are silver as well. Don't pick the roses. Continue on your way, and you will find your fortune." "Oh, thank you, wise men," said the first Amalfi. And just as the wise men said, he slept in the field that night. The wise man wandered off on his journey, white-haired, leaving the first Amalfi in the field. Well, he waited for that first star to rise, And sure enough, it was brighter than all the other stars in the sky. And its rays pointed clear across, a path clear for Amalfi to follow. He got up in the morning, could see exactly which way to go, and followed the path that the star had made with its rays. He traveled along and came to the stream. It was rushing faster than anything he had ever seen. It seemed deep, and the first Amalfi walked to the edge of the water, looked in and could not see the bottom. Foam and the spray hit him in his face and he wiped it off. But he remembered the white-haired man's words, and he stepped bravely into the stream. And sure enough, he could walk across. When he got to the middle, the water calmed. And as he got toward the edge, he spotted the lilies. White they were, and the petals were so fine, it almost looked like you could see through them. First Amalfi looked, he thought, I would like to pick just one. Oh, no, 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 I mustn't, he thought, and he passed the first few. But as he got further into the stream, there were more and more white lilies, until he thought, maybe the white-haired man was mistaken. I will just pick one. He picked up that one, and the minute it touched his hands, he was transformed into a fish, dove deep into the depths of the stream, and swam away. Back at the home, the other two brothers wondered what had happened to the first Amalfi, for time had passed and he had not returned. So his father sent the second Amalfi. He said, you must go and seek your fortune. All right, said the second Amalfi, I will, and find out what happened to your brother too. The second Amalfi was also given a sack, and in it a loaf of barley bread, and off he went down the path. Well, just like his brother, along the side he saw the white-haired old man. And the white-haired old man told the second Amalfi the same thing he told his brother. Sleep in the field, look for the star, cross the stream bravely, don't pick the lilies, don't pick the silver roses. And the second Amalfi assured the white-haired old man that he would listen, slept in the field, and the next day began his journey. He got to the stream as well, bravely stepped in and got across, and when he got to the white lilies, he would not even look at them. He kept his eyes straight ahead on the trees and got right to the edge of that stream. I did it, he thought. I have made it. And he walked along, but then he got to the meadow of the silver grass and the silver roses. Walking through it was a path, and he weaved his way through. Oh, the roses smelled so wonderful. The grasses were so beautiful. I'll just pick one, he thought. He reached out his hand and picked that rose, turned into a silver snake and slithered away among the grasses. Well, back at the home, all the sons that were left were the third Amalfi. We will send you, said the father, and be sure to find out what happened to your two brothers too. Again, he was given a sack, the third Amalfi, and a loaf of barley bread, and he traveled down the road. Sure enough, he also met the white-haired old man. And the white-haired old man gave the third Amalfi the same advice he gave his two brothers. I hope that you will be wiser than your brothers, said the white-haired man. You know what happened to them, said the third Amalfi. Yes, but I will not tell you yet. You must get through the test first. All right, said the third Amalfi. I can do it. And the next day, Follow the path of the star, through the stream, past the lilies, and through the silver grasses and the roses until he got to the other side. When he got to the other side, the landscape changed instantly and he was in the middle of a desert, a big desert, and he began to walk. Hunger and thirst overcame him. The heat of the sun beat down on him all day, but the third Amalfi continued on his path over the red earth. Far into the desert he traveled. And then he thought he saw something flying toward him. When he looked up, it was something flying toward him. It was a palace, a flying palace. And it got close enough that the third Amalfi could see on the balcony a beautiful maiden crying. Oh no, said Amalfi, why does she cry? But the minute he reached out to touch her, the palace floated far away and was gone from view. Oh no, said the third Amalfi, I must find her. I must find why was she crying in a floating palace. I have never seen anything like that before. And when he turned his head, he realized he was not alone. For following him was a little hen with golden speckled feathers pecking at the earth. Come, come, little hen, said the third Amalfi, come into my arms. I will not harm you. We will find refuge together in this hot, dry land. And he went to pick up the hen. And as soon as he touched the hen transformed into the white-haired old man. Ah, said the white-haired old man, you are smarter than your two brothers. You did exactly as I told you to do. Yes, I did, said the third Amalfi. I am so surprised to see you here. Because you have done as you were told, I will grant you one wish. One wish, thought the third Amalfi. Well, I know what I wish. I wish that you would change my brothers. Bring them back safe and sound. Ah, said the wise old man, your brothers have been changed. Into what? Said the third Amalfi. One is a fish who swims in that stream, said the white-haired old man, and the other is a snake who slithers in the grass of the silver roses. Change them back. Send them home to my parents. All right, said the white old man. Your wish is granted. And in other parts of the land, sure enough, the two brothers were transformed back into themselves, and they traveled home where they were greeted by their parents. The white-haired old man looked at the third Amalfi. You may continue, he said, on to your journey, for your fortune is yet to be found. If you follow this path and continue, then you will find it. I wish to find the flying palace. All in good time, said the white-haired old man. There are other things for you to discover first. All right, said the third Amalfi. You have guided me so far, and therefore I will follow your words. And the third Amalfi continued on his way alone. Well, as he traveled through the desert, the landscape began to become more friendly. Green grass grew, and he began to see bushes and trees, bushes that had berries on them for him to eat, fresh-watered spring for him to drink and to refresh himself. And he came to a tall mountain, the tallest he'd ever seen. For 7 days he climbed to the top of that mountain. And when he got to the top, he could see in the distance a castle on the land. It was not the floating palace, but a different castle. It seemed to shimmer and glow in the light. It looks enchanted, thought the third Amalfi, but he spent the next 7 days traveling to it. And when he got there, there was no one else but him. He walked into the door, and inside the room, there were five little tables. He went to the first table, and there was a bowl of porridge there. Ah, porridge! And a note, thought the third Amalfi. He lifted the note and read, "This porridge is a gift from the fairies. Eat it, and you shall never be hungry again."
"All right," said the third Amalfi, and he eagerly ate the porridge.
Instantly, all of his hunger vanished, and he thought, "Now I am ready for the next table." He walked over, and there was a bottle of juice and a note. "A gift from the fairies," said the note, "that you may never know thirst again."
The third Amalfi lifted that and drank all of it down, and his thirst was gone.
Walked to the third table, where there was some oil in a small tiny jar. "Use this oil, and you will have the strength of 1,000 men.
"All right," said the third Amalfi, and he took the oil upon his hands and rubbed it on his arms and on his legs. And instantly he felt invincible, as if he could conquer anything.
He went to the fourth table, where there was a jar of ointment. "A gift from the fairies for your eyes. Close your eyes, put a little bit on the lids, and you will be able to see deep into the depths."
"All right," said the third Amalfi, and he took a little bit on each of his fingers, rubbed it on his eyes, opened them. "Well, I don't feel any different," said the third Amalfi, "but you never know, this could come in handy."
And on the last table there was a sword. "This sword is the sword of invincibility. Take it and use it for goodness in the name of the fairies." The third Amalfi took the sword, put it on his belt, gave an offering of thanks to the fairies for all that they had offered him. Grateful he was in his heart, and he left and traveled on his journey. He did not know where he was going, but he followed the path as he had before. And there in the distance, after 5 days of travel, he saw the palace, the flying one. And as he approached it, it hovered and landed on the earth. The third Amalfi, he ran into the door, found his way right to the balcony, and sure enough, he found the girl who was weeping. "I have traveled far to find you," he said. "Why do you cry?" "I cry," she said, "because I am a prisoner here." And the third Amalfi looked down, and sure enough, her feet had chains on them. "Well, let me get these off of you." "You cannot, for the monster has put them there."
"Monster," said the third Amalfi.
"Yes, monster. You see, I was traveling. I was at my home. I was getting ready to go on a trip with my father. We were going to travel, and he was out hunting when he wounded a beast, a monster of unknown worlds. Well, the monster said that my father would be forever punished. And as I entered the woods behind my father, the monster took me, and I have been trapped here on this palace, in this balcony since then."
"Where is the monster?" said the third Amalfi, "for I will fight him and I will free you."
"Well, the monster is in the 100th room. This castle has 100 rooms in it, and he is in the 100th. "Do you know where it is?" said the third Amalfi.
"I do not," she said, "for again, I have been chained here since I came."
The third Amalfi rubbed his eyes, remembering the ointment he had put on them. And as he lay on the floor and put his head down on the boards, he could see through the entire palace, room by room, until he found the 100th.
It was a small room far in the very bottom of the castle,
where he saw the monster sleeping.
Off went the third Amalfi through each of the rooms until he finally got to the 100th. And when he did, he walked up. And with his foot, he nudged the foot of that monster. said the monster. Who dares to wake me from my slumber?
I do, said Amalfi. I am here. You have kept that young woman prisoner for too long, and I am going to defeat you.
Is that so? Said the monster, and he rose to a height twice as tall as Amalfi.
I will let you have her under one condition.
What? Said Amalfi.
You must defeat me in a challenge.
One challenge, said Amalfi?
Maybe, said the monster, maybe two.
All right, say your first challenge, said Amalfi.
All right, said the monster, and he walked over, picked up an iron ball.
Amalfi would have to put his whole hands around it to be able to pick it up, both of them. He looked at the size, the girth of the ball. But the monster picked it up with ease and with one hand tossed it, and it became wedged in the wall that faced the outside. He looked at it wedged in the wall, and he said, "All right, I have stuck it in the wall. Let's see what you can do." Amalfi walked over, and with all of his strength, he pulled that ball off, and with a mighty heave, he threw it with such force that it split the wall in two, continued on the other side, and disappeared into the distance.
You're very strong, said the monster. I am surprised that you were able to throw that as far. Now, you must wrestle me. And the two began to grapple, the third Amalfi putting his hands on the monster. Back and forth they went, one on top of the other, to the ground, to the sky, until, with a giant throw, the third Amalfi threw the monster against the wall. He landed on the earth, and the minute he landed, he disappeared.
Takes care of that, said the third Amalfi, and he went back up to the balcony, and with the sword of invincibility from the fairies, he cut the chains from the maiden.
Well, instantly, the minute she was freed, the palace began to lift, and the two were quite startled to see that they were floating over the sky and through the land. And then the maiden began to laugh.
What is so funny, said Amalfi.
Look, she said, that is my father's kingdom. And as the palace flew closer and landed upon the earth, the king and all of his people came out, greeted Amalfi, and the long-lost princess were grateful for his strength and his bravery and his good, kind heart. His family was sent for, his mother and his father and his two brothers. All were asked to live in the kingdom, and there was such a party that I'm sure it is still going on today, and they lived happily for the rest of their days.